you all be seated, and please know that there's water and hot chocolate and some cookies and brownies in the back there if you need a little picker-upper. This is the time of day where sometimes we need a little to keep us attentive. Well, I want to welcome you all to the St. Thomas Aquinas lecture this evening. And to welcome us officially is Dr. Mark Camille, who is president of Albertus Magnus College. Dr. Camille.
Thank you, Sister Anne, and good evening. It is, I've come to say pretty much every time I stand in front of any Albertus crowds that it is a pleasure to be with you, and indeed it is. And I know you're in for a treat tonight because we got to have a little bit of a preview today over the lunch hour when Dr. Tucker shared an abridged version with some of our students and faculty members and staff members. But as I think about tonight, and admittedly I'm going to be very brief because you don't want to hear from me, but in thinking about tonight, we are here because of the St. Thomas Aquinas lecture. And of course, one of the great scholars in the Dominican tradition, and if we think about one of the tenets of the Dominican charism in education, it is the search, the pursuit of truth, but then also to share that knowledge that we learn. And I think tonight, the subject, the journey of a universe, through the universe, it will be just that, and I know you'll enjoy it, but I also think that it's appropriate to do it here at Albertus Magnus College, as a liberal arts-based institution, an institution that stresses the interdisciplinarity and interconnectedness of the various disciplines in the world that we live in. So I know you're in for a treat. It is a pleasure to be with you. Many of you I've met, others I have not yet had the pleasure of doing so, and I'll hope to say hello at the end of the evening. But welcome, we're thrilled you're here. Thank you, Sister.
This evening, we welcome Dr. Mary Evelyn Tucker to present her lecture, Journey of the Universe, an Epic Story for Our Shared Future. I hope that some of you have had the opportunity to view the Emmy Award-winning film, Journey of the Universe, which was written by Dr. Tucker and Brian Swim. This is a story that inspires wonder as we begin to understand the complexity of the universe through science and appreciate such beauty through poetry, art, liturgy, and religion. The interdisciplinary part of this that Dr. Camille talked about. I am sure if any of you viewed the film that you were awed with the content and the beauty of it. If Thomas Aquinas was here with us, and he is here in spirit, I am sure he would be delighted with the science and the scope of this film. Aquinas once said, "Wonder is the desire for knowledge," and certainly the journey of the universe leads one to wonder. This wonder is a cause of delight because it brings us hope of discovery and new knowledge. In introducing our speaker tonight, it's hard to know where to begin or where to end, so I offer a few highlights of Dr. Tucker's accomplishments, and they are many. Dr. Tucker is senior lecturer and research scholar at Yale University, where she has appointments in the School of Forestry and Environmental Studies, as well as the Divinity School and the Department of Religious Studies. She teaches in the joint MA program in Religion and Ecology and directs the Forum on Religion and Ecology at Yale with her husband, John Grimm. Dr. Tucker received her PhD from Columbia University in Japanese Confucianism. Since 1997, she has been a research associate at the Reischer Institute of Japanese Studies at Harvard. Due to her concern for the growing environmental crisis, Dr. Tucker, along with John Grimm, organized a series of 10 conferences on world religions and ecology at the Center for the Study of World Religions at Harvard and produced a series of 10 volumes for their conferences. Dr. Tucker founded and directed the Forum on Religion and Ecology at Yale. Among her publications are Moral and Spiritual Cultivation in Japanese Neo-Confucianism. She co-edited Buddhism and Ecology, Confucianism and Ecology, Hinduism and Ecology. Along with John Grimm, she edited Worldviews and Ecology, Religion and Ecology, Can the Climate Change, and Ecology and Religion. And Dr. Tucker also wrote World Wonder, Religions Enter Their Ecological Phase. Dr. Tucker and John Grimm studied world religions with Thomas Berry, who I'm sure many of you are familiar with, in graduate school, and worked closely with him for 30 years. They are the managing trustees of the Thomas Berry Foundation, and Tucker has edited several of Berry's books, and she told me this evening she's working on a biography. Also, Dr. Tucker and John Grimm have spoken and written extensively on Pope Francis's papal encyclical on ecology, Laudato Si. Dr. Tucker was a member of the Earth Charter International Council. And this is just some of what she has accomplished. We are very blessed this evening to have her join us at Albertus for this Thomas Aquinas lecture. Dr. Tucker.
Thank you so much to your president, to your past president, Sister Anne, and to all of you who are coming this evening, and some friends like Barbara and Chris coming down from Rhode Island. I so appreciate that. Thomas Berry was named after Thomas Aquinas. He took that as his religious name. So I just wanted to celebrate the occasion of this lecture. Thomas Berry's work was deeply inspired by this remarkable Dominican. But as Sister Joan mentioned at the noon talk, why was he so inspired? Because Aquinas really understood that the universe is the first revelation. It's the first revelation of the holy, of the sacred. And it's where we find our place of belonging, of being and searching for wonder. So that's why Thomas Aquinas is fundamental to this talk, fundamental to this work, fundamental to everything that Thomas Berry did. How many of you know Thomas Berry a little bit? Wonderful. So he's a great inspiration for us. He married us 40 years ago, actually, and his work is essential for our understanding certain aspects of why a story is something that can bring us together in our times. Those of you who might know Teilhard de Chardin, how many of you know Teilhard? So Teilhard is also a huge inspiration for this work, and we run the American Teilhard Association, happy to have you join that, and so on. So this is a story, and the notion is, as Teilhard said, we are a human phenomenon living within this great unfolding universe. Now, Teilhard didn't even know how old it was, you see, but he had tremendous insight into these dynamic, extraordinary processes of evolution. And Thomas got this idea, this inspiration, we must tell this as a story. So what we're inviting us into this afternoon is, if we met each other, we'd start to tell our stories, who we are, those of you who are artists, what you paint, what you do. So living within a universe story, the invitation is a great transformation and inspiration. So, as you may know, this began with the book Universe Story by Brian Swinn and Thomas Berry. It took them 10 years to do this. This is the first telling of the universe story. And getting all the science right and so on was a huge effort. This also took us 10 years to do. This little book, it's a poetic telling of this story. And we brought together scientists to help us get each part, each chapter, each word actually was vetted. And this is published by the Science Division of Yale. But we wanted to tell it in a different way than a NOVA presentation or something that gave us a feeling of how are we part of this. So it's a scientific fact. It's a metaphor in the film, a metaphor with the balloon, the expansion of the universe and so on, and then a sense of meaning. You see, science doesn't always give us a sense of meaning. So that's what this is, a fusion of science and humanities, religious sensibilities, as Sister Anne said. The book has been translated into a lot of European languages, Asian languages, and so on. And I share this only by way of saying there's a yearning on our planet for something larger. And that is very exciting, something that pulls us together as planetary citizens, as planetary people. Now, this film, I think, is really born of the desire of the universe to tell its story, because it was difficult, you know. It was really a long journey, raising the money, getting the crew. We filmed in Samos, in Greece, and so on. We worked with someone who had worked with the Cosmos series of Carl Sagan. Every piece of this was carefully, you know, decided on the music, the images, and so on. And we were very fortunate that it went on PBS for several years. It kind of flew under the radar screen of this evolution and origin problem. Again, for mysterious reasons, this project is way larger than us. I think something is being birthed in our times to tell this story. So we also have these what's called MOOCs, massive open online classes, and you can watch this, you can get the lectures there, and there's 20,000 people around the world watching Journey of the Universe and this and reading the book and so on. This is all in Chinese too. They've been translated, the film has been translated into Chinese, so Brian's talking Chinese in the film. It's marvelous, isn't it? And we've shown it on pretty much every continent. So the conversations, though, are a piece of this that some people don't yet know about, and I think they're valuable for several reasons. Scientists are telling their part of this evolutionary story. So the emergence of stars or galaxies, how did that happen? And those of us who are not scientists, they tell it in a way we understand and can be in awe of these processes. All the way down to how Earth systems work and so on. And the environmentalists, I do interviews with them to tell us, okay, what's the implication of this great story for the great work that needs to be done? So how cities need to have an ecological component, how food systems, I understand you are having a garden here, food, as we do over at Yale, and food issues are hugely important to all of us, but the next generation is passionate about this. So there's people I've interviewed about race here are saying, why is this something that brings us together as a people? So two African Americans that I've interviewed and so on. So they're only about 20 minutes. They're great for using in your parish or your community centers or in your classes. And Sister Anne can let you know how to get the password protected site so you can watch the film and watch these conversations as you like. Now here's kind of the message in a nutshell. We like to talk about deep time, this evolutionary story that's bringing us a sense. The awareness just of evolution lights up a sense of beauty, of complexity. This is why Teilhard was so inspired by telling that story in The Phenomenon of Man. At the same time, we're in a period, as you well know, of extinction, of loss of species, of ecosystems being destroyed, of water systems being destroyed. We're right here on the Long Island Sound. It's taken a long time to clean up some of the runoff of farms and just pesticides. I cannot believe how people can put pesticides on their lawn knowing it's going to go right into the Long Island Sound. So there's all kinds of groups, as you know, trying to work on these issues right here locally. But we can talk about water issues in Flint, Michigan. How environmental issues are not a political issue. It's what is water, air, soil, food? What is health? What is going to happen to our children? And that's why the Flint, Michigan story is so sad, because the damage done to many of those children is irreversible, you see. So these are issues that bring us together to say the flourishing of the human, the health of the human and the health of these ecosystems matter for all future generations, for all future generations. So we're living between beauty and destruction. We're living between hope and despair sometimes. We're living between possibilities of change and frustration. These kinds of things tear us apart at times, but this story, I think, has a possibility of renewing our energy, renewing our sense of hope, what Teilhard would call the zest for life, the zest for life. So we know we have these climate change problems, eco-justice. There's 19 million refugees around the world. There's still people in this country who haven't recovered from climate-induced hurricane disasters. $600 billion of destruction last year alone in this country. My brother's head of Chubb Insurance in New York. Do you know what this means for insurance industries? We are now number one in the world for disasters. Okay? And these are climate related. So the impact on people who may never recover their homes, their sense of community, and so on, New Orleans, Houston, Sandy, the effects on Long Island, on New Jersey, biodiversity loss. I don't want to go on and on about these problems, but we have to be aware of them. Our news doesn't tell us the full story. We're living in a bubble of all kinds of denial. But we are in a sixth extinction period. I don't know if you've even heard the term, and that's okay, because most Americans haven't. How many of you have heard the term sixth extinction? Okay. Last one was 65 million years ago when an asteroid hit Mexico. But we are causing this extinction, partly by our explosion in one century from 2 billion to 6 billion people, and now over 7 billion people. So the cost for ecosystems, for species, is huge. And I'm going to talk about that in the Natural History Museum in New York. So I've spoken a little bit about food security and toxicities. We know plenty about the problems of inequities of wealth. This is true in India. I was just there in December. Huge inequities between wealth and extreme poverty. China is suffering the same problems. So consumerism. We've had this dream in this country of more and more stuff, that wealth is stuff, having stuff, whether it's a house, new clothes, et cetera, et cetera. That dream is no longer functioning, in case you didn't notice. It is no longer functioning. Why are we the most addicted, unhealthy society on the planet, whether it's drugs, alcohol, opioids? There's no other society as deeply addicted. And we've got to confront this consumerist, materialist dream is not working. And that's what Thomas Berry said in 1978. We need a new story. We need a new vision to inspire what is the flourishing of life. The flourishing of life. Those of you who have children and grandchildren, you must be thinking about this. We don't, John and I, and I'm so happy for John and my wife, we don't have children, and it's not that we didn't want them, but we feel our students are our children, this next generation are our children. We have got to be thinking about what is their future, what is their children's future. So we've got to reinvent the dream, because the dream drives the action. So we are now in an age, how many of you have heard of this term, the Anthropocene? Okay, so human-induced planetary change all over the planet, all over the planet. And partly India's developing, China's developing, we're consuming 6% of the world's population, but we cause 30% of the world's consumption and pollution and so on. Some responsibility here, right? Okay. So Thomas Berry would say we're moving in a geological age. The Anthropocene, by the way, is saying the last 10,000 years of human history and culture, the rise of the great world religions. Christianity is only 2,000 years old, in case you didn't, you know. But the whole 10,000-year period where humans have flourished around the planet, the birth of Hinduism and Buddhism and Confucianism, Greek philosophy, Christianity, Judaism, all of this has taken place in a very short period of time, really 5,000 years, okay, and indigenous peoples 100,000 years before that. In a flash, we have changed a geological gift, because we're shutting down these ecosystems, you see. So this era that's 10,000 years old, we're saying we need a real name for it. That's what the scientists are saying. So they're calling it the Anthropocene era. It was before the Holocene era, last 10,000 years. But Barry had an even larger view. He said, we're shutting down 65 million years of evolution from the end of the dinosaurs to now. And we are in the sixth extinction period. Natural History Museum of New York, a plaque on the hall of biodiversity that says we are in the sixth extinction period. We can stem the tide of destruction. I'm not going to reverse this, but we can stem the tide of destruction. So I'm not saying something that scientists aren't very aware of. They are. Most of the public is not, but we will be. So at the same time, and this is the sliver of hope, the sliver of possibility, the sliver of transformation, that we are awakening to this new intimacy with the universe, with Earth, that we are stardust. What an amazing idea. Those of you who saw the Cosmos series with Carl Sagan, you can remember, he would say, we're part of billions and billions of stars. But when we have an explosion, a supernova explosion, which, by the way, our parents didn't really realize this. Certainly our grandparents didn't. That's why this is new. This has possibilities for lighting up human imagination, joy, transformation. All of the elements of life come out of starburst. Isn't that amazing? Truly, carbon-based life here on this planet, why we have green and flourishing ecosystems, why we have water and so on, came out of starburst. So we are cosmic beings. You see, life is a cosmic being. This whole picture you will all recall in 68, you know, when we got the first pictures from space and how it transformed us. And now we're in the midst of trillions of galaxies, right? We're still the only living planet that we know. And people ask me, well, is there life elsewhere? I'm concerned about life right here. You know, right here. All the exoplanet studies that's going on at Yale, I'm like, fine. But this is the most beautiful, extraordinary home we know. Let's think about it for future generations. And we can do this. We can absolutely do this. So a single cell, again, to me, I am continually amazed by this. It took 1 billion years for our Earth to develop the first cell. We're 4.6 billion years as an Earth system. We're 14 billion years as a universe story. So it's almost 10 billion years before Earth emerges. Isn't that staggering? Doesn't that just change everything about who we are, where we've come from, why we're here? So a billion years for the first cell to emerge. Multicellular life, another billion years. And then the explosion way later of plants, of the greening of the Earth. If you have a book, The Immense Journey, Lauren Isley, how flowers changed the world, and this imaginative telling of the explosion of flowers and colors around the planet. Stupendous. Of course, animals, the sentience of animals, their awareness, people are even saying they had their own culture. We know that there's mourning and even death, a feeling about death among many of the mammalian life forms, that elephants mourn their dead, that birds in their migrating patterns are unbelievably sophisticated in ways we don't. Fish, the migration of salmon back to their original spawning grounds and spawning again and dying so that new life forms can emerge in that whole ecosystem enriched by their death. The littlest glimpses we can get into the world, the mammalian world, the marine world, right off the coast here. These are incredibly intelligent groups, bees, and how they function. And that's why this tragedy of the loss of bees is so huge. So each part of this unfolding journey gives us a sense of wonder, beauty, awe, astonishment. And of course, our own human world and our affinity with certain living creatures, be it our pets and so on. So all of this is pointing toward a tremendous interconnectedness of life. How exciting. And this is saying that the ecology and community of life is giving us these new values. They're old and new. Native peoples understood them, and we do in certain ways, but we've got to own our interdependence, our interconnection, our relationality, our flourishing. We could not exist without water, right? We couldn't exist without air. That's how fundamental our connections are. You see, that's why these aren't political issues, they are human issues, what keeps us alive. And I'll take a drink here. What keeps us alive. It's very simple, really. We do have in our modern values, French Revolution, Declaration of Independence, our own revolution, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These are great values, but they're very much directed towards the individual. Our life, our liberty, our freedoms, and so on. Happiness for me, this dream that we have that's distorted. So we need more values. We need a sense of life that includes all species, liberty that requires responsibility for the Earth community, not just our rights, but responsibility, happiness with a sense of belonging. Why are our young people so sad and alienated and disconnected? Of course, family structures have fragmented, but there's something more going on. You see, where is the sense of belonging and community? And this can light people up. Some seniors left the, seniors meaning like us, left the noon talk and said, I love that I'm part of Stardust. I feel like I belong, you see? And that happens with young people too. So the quality of life we know is more than the quantity of material goods. And that's why a place like Albertus Magnus, which has a value-oriented education, can help students make this shift. It's not easy. It's going to take a lot of dedication, those teaching this insight curriculum for the first year students. We commend you. You know, we celebrate what you're trying to do. It's not easy, even at Yale. So again, against all odds, I'm just trying to open up the possibilities here. And you'll be like, is this really true? But I do believe, this is a Teilhardian belief, if you will, that we're moving from competing nation states to the flourishing of a multicultural and planetary civilization. I've been blessed to travel a lot. I've lived in Japan for almost 3 years. I've been to almost every part of Asia. I lived in England, thanks to the Notre Dame nuns from Trinity, and I taught in their school in Japan. So we're moving from this declaration of independence moment, which has been very important, but to a declaration of interdependence. This has been written. It took almost 10 years, but it's been written. And this is the Earth Charter that Sister Anne mentioned. I'll just mention the three parts and then tell you the origin. So the preamble, the beginning, emphasizes this cosmology, that we're part of a vast evolving universe. Earth, our home, is alive. Now, I was part of this drafting committee. There were about 25 people from all over the world. A scientist from Tufts, Eric Chasen, suggested that first line, we're part of a vast evolving universe, completely coherent with Teilhard, with Thomas, with Brian Swim, with Journey of the Universe. Earth, our home, is alive came from indigenous perspectives, okay? And in 1997, when the first iteration of this charter came forward in Rio, Gorbachev, who asked for it, took us 5 years to get the first iteration, he held it up and he said, you know, these are the 10 commandments for our future. And down the row next to us, indigenous peoples were weeping because they felt for the first time their worldview was in an international charter. There's now a declaration, Universal Declaration of the Rights of Mother Nature, that was drafted in Colombia in South America. It was brought to the floor of the UN and voted on. Universal Declarations of the Rights of Mother Nature. And Thomas was talking about this as well. What a shift, you see? It's happening. We just have to get outside our bubble. So we have many grassroots movements of interdependence which are illustrating this. So people say, what can you do? There's thousands of them out there. The climate march, I don't know if any of you went to this in New York, 400,000 people. I'm from New York. It was one of the greatest days for New York. And of that, 10,000 were from the religious communities, by the way. So they are definitely getting into this. It's a moral issue. It's an ethical issue. How can we not, you see, be part of it? There are all kinds of movements for eco-justice. This changes everything from Naomi Klein, extraordinary book. She calls this blockadia all around the world that are opposing unrestrained extraction industries like fishing, forest extraction, mining. Now the Pope was just in Latin America, and I'm sure if you read any of the reports, which didn't appear in any of our major newspapers, so you have to look on the alternative news sources, and he was critiquing extractive industries, okay? And that's what Laudato Si is about. He's saying eco-justice, and he was holding up the rights of indigenous peoples against this extractive industries that are coming in largely from the first world, and that includes places like Japan and China now too, but this is something our tradition is holding up as well. If you were aware of the protests on the West Coast, how many of you are aware of this? Almost 2 years ago now. So Cheryl, know, these are people out there in their kayaks against this huge, huge drilling machine that wanted to go up to the Arctic to drill in one of the most pristine areas of our whole landscape. They prevented that from happening. Shell backed away. Those of you who know Standing Rock out of North Dakota, the native peoples who were talking about water protectors, non-violent, unbelievable, absolute one of the most significant movements of our time, 12,000 people going out there to support this non-violent movement to protect the water, started by young people, running very important prayers and ceremonies to do this. If you see the pictures of what they endured in sub-zero cold, like we've just been through, unbelievable, unbelievable. So here's Journey of the Universe. In the midst of all of these conflicting movements and so on, it's trying to give this integrating story of science and humanities. Not just science over there, humanities over here, facts over here, me over here. Something that brings it together because our students realize they're inheriting a schizophrenic world, a worldview, very divided. So here again, this sense, the animal behavior world has given us an explosion of knowledge about the interaction of animals and their knowledge and so on. So we're trying to move all of us into this broadening participation in the whole, an awe that evokes action, a reverence that inspires responsibility, and an ethics, not just for the individual, but for the common good. You know, the tradition I study most, Confucianism, that's influenced more people on the planet than any other tradition, even including our own Christianity, just by the sheer size of numbers and the antiquity of the civilization. Everything about Confucianism, you cultivate yourself, but for a common good, to contribute to the society. everything from the lower on down. That is a very different communitarian ethics, you see. And one of the things that attracted me, not perfect, didn't deal with women well, et cetera, but it's aspirational, you see. Now, I'm going to tell you this story that brings the extinction issues to a highlight. So, when we finished the conferences at Harvard in the mid-90s, we went down to the Natural History Museum. And all of this, by the way, was very difficult to do. It was very difficult to do at Harvard, to do conferences on religion and ecology. There's no field then, and religion in these kinds of institutions right down the street is very much disregarded, except at a place like the Divinity School. But, you know, we're barnacles on a very big ship over there. And someone said, well, barnacles are ecosystem changers, so maybe. So we go down to the Natural History Museum, and we're kind of in fear and terror, and we go into the provost's office, Mike Novacek, who's still provost. We get in there, and 10 minutes into the conversation, he says, I understand what you're trying to do, to bring religious spokespeople here and to speak about the value of nature. He says, I understand, because my aunt read me Teilhard as a young child. Isn't that amazing? You never know, you know, and Teilhard's had an amazing influence on so many people. And he said, we will give you the IMAX theater rent free because we think this is so important for a sense of values and ethics for the natural world. He said, because, this is 1998, we've just had a search for an ornithologist, people who study birds, and six of the PhD candidates for this position at the Natural History Museum, four of them had their birds go extinct while they studied them. Now, that's a wake-up call, right? And every time I tell the story, people are like, still, just, you know, hits you in a deep level. And he said, because of that, we realize we have to be a museum reaching out to a larger public and telling this story. And so what they did is they created, for many reasons, not just that, but this Hall of the Universe. Some of you seen this. I hope you can just get on the train one day and go down there. It's quite extraordinary. And what I'm trying to say is they're telling the universe story. And what happens in this amazing Rose Hall is you walk down the spiral staircase, kind of like the Guggenheim Museum, and every step is like a million years, and you begin to you feel the physicality of this time, this deep time. You come to the very end of the spiral staircase, and there's one human hair under glass, and it says, this is all of human history. It's kind of amazing. You know, we're about 200,000 years old as a Homo sapiens species. That is very, very short for a process as long as this. So, and what they did originally when this came out, you went through a big bang, Brian likes to call it the great flaring forth, and when you came out and you walked down this, they gave you a passport and they said, you are a citizen of the universe. That's a different mindset, you see? That's in a public setting. So it's not just us doing the universe story over here. Hundreds of thousands of people go through this. My friend works there. She said the other day when it snowed, you know, the big snowstorm, people were lined up to get in. 30,000 people that day, and they let them all in for free, which is so fabulous. People are dying for this information, you see? So they also set up the Hall of the Earth. And here you can see one of the latest theories about, did life actually come from the deep sea, the vents that they discovered maybe 25, 30 years ago in the deep oceans where different forms of life live. It's just astonishing. You can see plate tectonics, the movement that makes this a volcanic living planet, or the movements of our great continental masses. That took 50 years for the scientific community to get their mind around. But now we have the pieces, you see, to tell this story. Here is this hall of biodiversity that, as I said earlier, on the floor, a plaque, we're in the midst of an extinction period, but we can stem the tide of destruction. And then it shows, here's what we're doing to preserve ecosystems. here's what's being lost. And you walk back and forth, and you can see this juxtaposition. And again, I think students at Yale have a absolutely, I would say, unstoppable sensibility that they can make a difference in between these issues. They have grown up with more environmental facts than any generation. And why they are so inspiring to me is exactly, they're not giving up. You know, we can sit here in our older age and be like, oh my God. They have ingenuity, they have energy, they have ideas. I take my hat off to them. So this whole notion then, we're revising the role of humans, the citizens of the universe, Natural History Museum. We're members of an Earth community that the Earth Charter points to. And as Laudato Si says, kinship that embraces humans and nature. Kinship is a fabulous idea. It's very ancient with native peoples and so on. We're kin to all living beings. It's why totems, you know, that you wear an animal skin, that you have a feather in your hair. We're linking to the storied world, the living world. It's part of who we are. So this is happening, is what I'm saying, and it's being given to all of us. So the question then is, how can humans become a mutually enhancing presence for the Earth community? And this phrase, mutually enhancing, is Thomas's phrase. I think it's marvelous, because some people are saying we're mutually deleterious, you know, we're problematic. No, we can be, we are, in our best forms, mutually enhancing. And the most positive things about our own societies, we are the most generous and philanthropic society on the planet. You know, I said we're on this hand, but on the other hand, when people are in need, the rush, you know, to send aid, to send money overseas and here, we have a generosity of spirit that can do this. Now, because of this awareness of our relatedness to cosmos and Earth, we have a common evolutionary heritage. The film says the stars are our ancestors. And I say this in China, and they're just like amazed, because ancestors are so huge. You know, people visiting graves, thinking about their grandparents and their lineage. So our lineage is extended. How exciting is that? Very inspiring. A shared genetic language. Our genes are 99% the same as chimps and the great primate world. These are our cousins. And why is Jane Goodall, who hopefully will be speaking at Yale next year, why is she the most famous and known scientist on the planet? Because she recognized this great community of chimps as people, if you will, or as living, not just as objects. She gave them names. Okay, the genetic lineage is fabulous. And this fraternity with all life. So this is what we're trying to say, that we belong here, that we've always belonged here. That's how the film ends, the sense of belonging. And that we're participating in a great epic story. And we're actualizing this in the arts. The painter is here tonight. In music, an oratorio has been composed around Journey of the Universe. Dance and so on. I just want to say one thing about belonging. We all want to belong. Right? Loneliness is a terrible thing, whether we're old or young. We want to belong, whether it's friends or partners or a community like Albertus Magnus. Here's what happened when the film was shown in a women's prison in Montana by a nun, Maria Gothwell. A lockdown security prison. This was men, actually. I'll tell you another about women. They put their hands through the food opening and clapped when this was over. Another group of women prisoners in New Jersey, the former governor there is showing the prison, they're showing it to these prisoners. The woman, I said, how did they react? Complete silence. And then one woman said, now I know where I belong. It's quite extraordinary. So this is not just a story for privileged people or scientists. It's a story for all of us. And it's why the race interviews are really important, because Carl Anthony, African-American leader, says this changed his life. Thomas Berry's Dream of the Earth completely changed his life. Another African-American woman taught these ideas in an inner city ghetto in Watts in LA, from the streets to the stars. These young students, middle school students, they're difficult, all summer long. They prepared this, and at the end of the summer, the whole neighborhood came to watch their presentations and so on. I mean, it can inspire all of us, you see. So here, the invitation then is acting on a sense of belonging, that new forms of ethics are forming, cosmological ethics and ecological ethics. There's a book now called Cosmic Ethics, because we're part of this. How cool is that? The response to its beauty and complexity requires responsibility for its continuity. Don't we want life to continue? Isn't this one of the most powerful instincts of humans? Why people want to have children? We want to have all of these life systems continue. And that new forms of education and economics and business and politics and ecology are emerging. I could tell you lots of fantastic things at the Forestry and Environmental Studies School, industrial ecology, climate change, et cetera, et cetera. So a lot of very hopeful things are happening with these new realizations of our interconnectedness. So I'm just going to conclude here with, again, the sense that we're part of galaxies and stars. We're part of a universe that's mysterious. When we look up at the night sky, I love to do that, we feel connected somehow, connected. This first picture from space gives us that sense of our living planetary system. How beautiful is this? How complex? How inspiring? The picture from the moon to the Earth, you know, really changed us. And then we have this great diversity, of course, of life forms, of children who are irrepressible for their sense of dance, of joy. And there's, by the way, some children's books by Jennifer Morgan, three books on the universe story for children. And she's doing a lot with Montessori teachers to teach this. The Montessori people are all over this story. So I'm going to conclude with Albert Einstein, one of the great iconic scientists, who said, a human being is a part of a whole called by us universe, a part limited in time and space. He or she experiences himself, his thoughts and feelings, as something separated from the rest, a kind of optical delusion of his consciousness. This delusion is a kind of prison for us, restricting us to our personal desires and affection for a few persons nearest to us. Our task must be to free ourselves from this prison by widening our circle of compassion to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature in its beauty. Let's give it up for Albert Einstein and that beautiful quote.
Dr. Tucker would be glad to do hear some comments and also some questions from you, but I often think sometimes it's good just to take a couple of minutes to reflect about what you've heard and kind of put it together, and you might want to have a little buzz at your tables about things you want to test out before we test it out with Dr. Tucker. Okay, so just take a couple minutes of quiet and then at your table, and then we'll open it up for discussion.
Very nicely done. Thank you. Thank you.
them for a little while. My prescription changed.
Well, you were doing what Dr. Tucker was talking about, creating the interconnectedness at your tables by the conversations you were having. So are there any comments you want to make or any questions that you want to direct to Dr. Tucker? I'm going to bring the microphone so people can hear you.
I have a teacher voice. I think you can hear
it. It doesn't work.
Okay. Just to say, I'm currently reading a book called Braiding Sweetgrass. Yeah. And there's a place in there, she teaches botany to college kids. And at one time she says, well, you guys are all in this class, you love the environment, you love the trees, you love nature. She said, how would you act if you knew that the environment and the trees loved you back? And the students couldn't answer that, so she kind of changed it. And she said, well, how would you, you know, act out in the world if you thought that they did? And yep. That interconnectedness is just resonates with me a great deal.
Thank you so much. So Robin Kimmerer, who teaches at Syracuse at their School of Forestry and Environmental Studies, we brought her last spring, and she talked at Yale. So you can, if you Google Yale Robin Kimmerer, you'll get the talk. It's very quick to, I think, find. And this book's Braiding Sweetgrass, which has sold 75,000 copies already, has electrified many, many people, precisely along the lines that you're speaking about, because as a trained scientist with a PhD in botany, she knows the science, but she's also an indigenous woman. And so the braiding is indigenous, what's called teak, traditional environmental knowledge and scientific knowledge coming together. It's a beautiful book. And just to bounce off of that, and again, thank you, one of the things we're gonna be doing in a conference in the fall is exactly bringing together, Robin's gonna come, and others who are writing books about this sense of sentience, aliveness. Different, when I say sentience, I mean consciousness, but different from a human consciousness, right? But there's a book called How Forests Think. He's coming to Yale February 5th, getting a huge amount of attention about forests in the Amazon and their connectedness. There's a book called The Song of Trees, another a book, I forget the title, but you know how the roots connect, this livingness. So it's a growing literature, very much coherent with this, and it breaks through that objective, reductionistic use mentality of the world, which is why the most famous phrase of Thomas Berry is, the universe and the earth is a collection of subjects, not a collection of objects. See, subjectivity means our interiority, you could call it a soul or whatever, but interiority is in everything. It's in plants, it's in animals, and so on. And that phrase really has resonance with a lot of people. It's not just objects, you see. Factory farming of animals, which we did not do as we grew up, is saying, these aren't sentient. We're just going to mass them into these slaughterhouses and so on. You see, it's a mentality that is insidious. And that's why a change of worldview has huge implications for how we live. Okay, comment.
I'm so curious about global citizens, how you get global citizens. When you talked about the Earth Charter, and then you talked about the Universal Declaration of Rights of Mother Nature. I mean, I think it's the politics that always confuse me. How do you, is it through the United Nations? Who's the leaders? How do you, you know, if I look at our countries now, they seem so blocked down in disturbances that, how do you
right. You notice. Yeah. So my grandfather taught at Columbia, and he was a historian of Europe, and he was trying to explain the causes of the two world wars, and his specialty became nationalism, and he was a founder of the study of nationalism. His last book was Nationalism, a Religion. Carlton Hayes is his name. And this, we are still in a period of nationalism. But Teilhard, you see, would say, this is a period beyond the nation state. We're building a different future. And that is precisely our problem. So we're at a moment of breaking down politically, economically, socially, educationally, religious order struggling, but this breaking down, which is excruciatingly painful, and we're in a dreadfully painful time. But if we can get the Teilhardian long-term vision, it's a breakthrough to other ways of knowing, other ways of being in the world. And this will take all of our psychic and spiritual energy. You know, Teilhard was a stretcher bearer in World War I, in trench warfare. And this is one of the reasons I became so enamored of his work. He's not just a pie-in-the-sky optimist. He saw suffering. He knew suffering. He lost many of his family members while he was exiled to China for years and years, spent the whole war years over there. So, yes, the nation state is still has a grip on the human psyche. But the conferences I have been so privileged to go to, UN conferences and elsewhere, and the EU is way ahead in terms of this thinking, way, way ahead. They are leaders in environmental issues. They are leaders in social justice issues. There was just a huge demonstration in Berlin 2 days ago on food issues and how agriculture business is not a model for healthy food, and the kinds of things that Chris Lachlan has done at, and Barbara at Crystal Springs for community-supported agriculture. People are arising, you see? It's going to take our lifetimes, for sure.
Dr. Tucker, thank you. I was wondering in your studies if you have any opinion on whether or not there are life forms outside our universe. So we're speaking about our planet, but we don't even know how big everything is. So do you have an opinion?
Well, you know, I'm asked this from time to time, and as I think I said, maybe I said it at noon, but I am concerned about the living planet that we know. And exoplanets, the possibility, it's great for imagination, you know, Star Trek and Star Wars and all of this. Why is this so gripping for the human? You know, can we live elsewhere? Elon Musk trying to say we can go to space, you know, just concentrate on your electric cars, Elon. So I'm totally agnostic about it, to the point, and I'm not against NASA and space exploration and Hubble telescopes and all of that has given us a tremendous sense of our universe, but the need is here before us. It is huge. This is the most challenging time in human history. It is absolutely, unquestionably the moment that we have to stand up and create new values, new ways of being human. And people have had to do this over and over again. World War II was shattering, and many of you know this from your families. People lived through it, endured it. Brokaw called it the greatest generation. You know what? We have to be some kind of extraordinary generation right now. It's huge what we're up against. So, yes.
Thank you for a great talk. Dr. Tucker, one of the things I've always wondered is why we as a nation basically took our greatest natural resource, which was the American Indian, mm-hmm. who were so in touch with nature and could teach us so much, and we first of all got rid of them. They were important, but how important are they now? And then I kind of see things as a tipping point, like your work, the work of like James Cameron with Avatar to create a civilization that the mass audience can start to see, wow, they're being really trampled. And those messages, I think, I call the tipping point. There's a, like when it reaches critical mass, maybe a lot more people are going to understand that.
Yeah.
And then hopefully we'll see that change soon rather than later. I kind of call it the new mythology. Like, rather than some old mythology that we can't relate to. This is the new mythology?
Well, it's a new story. That's what Thomas Berry called it. And I appreciate and agree with, I think, what you're saying. Mythology might not be my term because it won't work with scientists, obviously. But we are myth-making animals. We are symbolic animals. And so it's why the arts are so important. And we light up by a story that's going to give us a sense of direction and purpose and so on. And it is to say that Genesis in a literal story is insufficient for our moment. You know, we grew up in a completely different age, and it's why it's hard for religious authors, even for the Catholic Church, to change, although evolution is not a problem with this pope or the last several popes. It's not a problem, you see? And these last several popes, Teilhard is a huge influence on them, okay? And why would this pope do an encyclical on the environment, which scientists across the street think is hugely important? I've been asked in many scientific contexts to talk about the encyclical. One of our scientists over there came back from, actually he's a lawyer, came back from the COP meetings in Paris with the agreement in December of 2015, and he said, and the Pope intended this, he said, we got an agreement in Paris because of the encyclical. Now, this isn't a Catholic. And he was even skeptical when he read it in the summer, and I asked him. That's what he said publicly over at the forestry school. Bill McKibben, one of our great environmental leaders, who we brought to Yale also in the fall, said at breakfast the next morning, he thinks the encyclical is the most important document of the 21st century. Are we picking it up? The Jesuit universities are, and they're making it central to their curriculum. I'm sure you've done a lot here, and so on. But that's amazing, you see? We have something that embodies this new world view. Teilhard's in one of the footnotes. The Earth Charter is in the footnote of Laudato Si, and we were thrilled about that, and so on. So anyway, there's a long answer, but a new story is emerging, for sure. And I just wanted to come back to this gentleman's question about life in outer space. You know, Ed Bass, who's a big supporter of Yale and actually a wonderful human being from Texas, did the Biosphere 2 down in Texas. Have you heard about that Biosphere 2? Trying to see, can we recreate life here? You know, I went to that years ago. It completely failed. Ants got inside. It didn't work. Humans argued among themselves. Columbia was asked to take it over, and I have. But we don't even know how to live on Biosphere 1, you see? Let's just create a Biosphere 2, which is another extension of your question. Can we live in outer space, you see? I don't think so. But it's an important question. I don't want to, you know, dismiss your question at all. Yeah.
Not so much a question, but a gut reaction. Oh. Not so much a question, but I'm just reacting to what I'm hearing. First of all, this awesome, wonderful other sense of embracing the world here, when at the same time, every day, every place, I see people embracing a nastiness, a terrible sense of ethics, something I thought we had surpassed a long time ago that is surrounding us. I see it in the supermarkets, at the gas stations, on the regular news. So there's a collision here of an emerging, arising negativity versus this beauty that you describe.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What do we do?
Well, it's heartbreaking. It leaves me sleepless. I'm right there with you. I'm absolutely right there with you. And I've been right there for 40 years because Thomas Berry has been talking about what's happening now. You see, a breakdown of ecosystems, a breakdown of civility, and they're interconnected. They're absolutely interconnected. So we did this as an antidote to the incredible suffering that we're going through. We are all deeply suffering, or we're not alive. You know, we're not alive. So the long-term sensibilities about these changes, and your husband said, well, maybe it can happen soon. Who knows what will happen soon? But let me just give you the example. I went to college in Washington, D.C., at Trinity, and we have an SND nun, Sister Reynolds, from there. I went there, and not to Mount Holyoke and some other colleges up here, because I wanted to be involved in civil rights and the anti-Vietnam War movement. I'm very much a 60s person, as I'm sure some of you are. You know, the civil rights movement, what a struggle. It's Greensboro, North Carolina, where Thomas Berry was from, the struggle to sit at a lunch counter in Woolworths and have a sandwich, cup of coffee, they were beaten. If you watch those pictures of nonviolent resistance of students, it's incredible. And it has to be said, one of the most horrific moments of my life was after Martin Luther King was killed, and I'm in Washington working on the Poor People's Campaign and so on, and into Washington moves the National Guard. The Capitol is surrounded. You know, this is a military moment. We had been through very difficult times. All of our cities exploded, as you remember. LA, Detroit has never recovered from the explosion after King's death. But my point is this, these were huge struggles, and we're in the same kind of moment of struggle. Where are the churches on civil rights? A lot of the churches, and I'm not just saying in the South, we're like, well, segregation, separate but equal, it's okay, because we're going to do schools for them, you know, but we're not going to integrate. Boston explodes with integration, Irish Catholics and so on, you know. Where were we for leadership on some of these issues? It's the same moment. Where are we for leadership on change for the environment, for civility, for equity issues? We have a long way to go. Yeah.
Doctor, thank you. A couple of years ago, I had an opportunity to work in Haiti for a short while, to put in a well with a group of us who were a non-government organization, a spiritual religious group. And when we were leaving, after accomplishing putting in a well, which fed provided water for 6,000 people, at the airport, we were talking to two or three other of the non-government organizations. And when we were comparing numbers, the NGOs, we serviced this particular 10-day period, the three of us, over 3,000 people, doctors, nurses, and us construction workers. That was a pretty impressive number. So when we look at what we're doing as private individuals who are highly efficient versus a government, it seems that a smaller group of ourselves, and I'm sure many in this room have done similar work, that's the answer, because the governments, you could see here in America, we're just shooting ourselves in the foot. So I wanted to say that,
yeah,
unless we act locally but think globally,
yeah,
that to paraphrase someone,
yeah,
we're in tough shape.
Yeah, no, thank you for that. And as Sister Ann said, who's from New Haven, the changes in New Haven that have happened over time are significant. And Rick Levin, our last president, Yale, you know, I think did a pretty good job on this town gown issue and so on. We have a long way to go still with the elitism of Yale. But I love your point about the local. It's so essential. Again, it's why these groups, helping with Long Island Sound, helping with the Connecticut River, helping with pesticides right in this area, and so on. Extremely important, absolutely essential. And you know, most mayors across this country have absolutely come out in favor of the agreement, the Paris Agreement. And you know, we're in this movement. We're in, and they were at the last meeting in Bonn, saying the American mayors are doing stuff. We know Jerry Brown is. We know Cuomo is. There's no fracking in New York, and so on. We got to think about what we're going to do in Connecticut. You see, for pipelines and fracking and so on and waste. So local is absolutely essential. Thank you.
You have time for one more. With this change in worldview that you speak of, how do you feel it's religion and spirituality is playing into this movement? Are you positive that there could be a greater connection or a greater integration, dialogue, whatever?
Yeah, thank you. These are all wonderful questions, and I really appreciate them, and I can stand here for a while afterwards and other questions. Welcome. So we have two projects. One is Journey of the Universe, and that's a very big project to birth. And another project is the World Religions and Ecology that we did at Harvard in the mid-90s, 10 conferences, as Sister Anne mentioned, and there's 10 volumes on what all the world's religions can contribute to the ecological and social crises that we're facing. And those were very exciting because we were trying to create a new field within academia, but also a new force in the society. So now we have this forum on religion and ecology at Yale. The Divinity School has a new master's in religion and ecology, just started this year. There's greening of seminaries and so on. Laudato Si, I've said several times, great potential here. But all of the world's religions are moving on these issues. In China, there's a whole movement called ecological civilization, and they are drawing on their traditions of Confucianism and Taoism and Buddhism for their sense of environmental ethics and protection. And that's exactly why we started these conferences at Harvard, to say environmental ethics in India and China and Latin America, they're not going to look like they will in the US. They're not going to, Christian environmental ethics in China? No. Ecological civilization is in the constitution in China. Xi Jinping speaks about it all the time. It's an aspiration, and sometimes it's going to be used like everything for politics and ideology. But it's also part of the constitution of Colombia and Bolivia that health of ecosystems is now a human right, you see? And that is partly inspired by the Pope's understanding and by religion. So just like the civil rights movement, there's going to be pushback and there's going to be push forward. But I think, and this is why we've devoted a good part of our lives to this religion and ecology movement, last year there were 7 jobs in religion and ecology across the country. Unbelievable. So a new field has been created in academia. This was at St. Olaf and Carleton and Dartmouth and Santa Barbara between their environment program and religious studies, and we were astonished. But so the next generation is completely into this. At the American Academy of Religion, we have a lunch before it all begins on each Friday in November before Thanksgiving. We had 120 people there in Boston for this movement. And I just want to end with, you know, we have so many problems in the church, so many problems in Christianity and so on, and we keep saying, what can we do? This is what young people want to hear. They know institutions are imperfect. They know we have failed them in lots of ways. But if we put before them a vision of a new story, we don't even have to mention Teilhard or Thomas or some of the background of this, but if they feel drawn to something inspiring that they can contribute to, and if they say, wow, the world's religions are changing on this, they will jump on board. There's no question. You see, we've got to own this sense of this beauty, of this complexity, and invite them into the conversation. They will come, we will follow. Thank you very much for coming today.